Good evening. Hey, Stato, hang on.
Hello.
There you go. That's better. Oh, good evening, Pete.
Hello, Pete, for the second time.
Hey there, Ashen.
Hey, Ashen.
Thanks for joining us in this very special episode of Willie and Stato at the Movies.
Is that what it is?
It is. It's very, very special. We're going out on Facebook. We're going out on Twitch. And, of course, on the YouTube. Today's show is just us talking about whatever we end up talking about.
That's right. So pull up a chair, light a fire in the fireplace, grab yourself something to drink.
Yeah.
Maybe a snack.
Get some popcorn or
set the projector up.
Yeah. Super 8.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever get any of those? Did you ever have any of those like projectors with the Super 8 stuff?
No. I've got a projector screen and like a LED projector.
Oh.
Hello, Michael.
Welcome. Yeah. Hey, Michael.
Random streams are the best.
Yeah, you're too young to remember those because I used to see them looking advertised.
I saw the movie
all the time and I was like, oh, look at that, as a Super 8 Planet of the Apes, you know, you could get all the movies.
I saw that movie and Super 8 wasn't anything like I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be all projected. There's aliens and Goonies.
That's right. That was J.J. Abrams does Spielberg.
That's right. It was E.T. on steroids, all it was.
Yeah, that was odd. I kind of enjoyed it, but I also thought it was kind of cynical. And yeah.
I would have loved it if the alien had been a threat. Like the little kids are the ones that take down this big nasty alien when the adults can't. That would have been cool.
Yeah.
Like if you took that and crossed it with like Battle Los Angeles. You know, except it's kids.
I can see that working.
Yeah. It would work amazingly.
It would. That would be good. Yeah, I'd get my popcorn out for that 3D.
Hmm. Right. Heck yeah. They had to be all family like. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but before we get going, I was going to kind of like just have a quick look and see.
Do it.
The campaign's doing because another backer.
85!
Another backer. 85 backers now. Yeah. Yes. I'm working away on it. Sorry, it's still going to be a wee bit late, but I'll be posting stuff up as I work on it and we're getting there. Things are coming in, they're getting printed and coming in, so on. But I'll just jump into the updates because everybody gets one of these lovely cards.
Yeah, wonderful baseball card for the collection.
Bampo, yeah. And everybody gets one of these gorgeous prints. Buy yourself.
Go on yourself,
Stato. Also added, because I've got a few of them lying around from the last campaign, I just put in the A3 Werewolf poster. So they're just a separate.
I like it.
Tier that I've got here now. If anybody's wanting a werewolf poster, you know where to go to get one now.
I'm looking forward to that making of book.
And the making of for anybody that missed it when they backed the campaign, I've now got it as a separate tier, so you can add it there as well.
Yeah, buddy, I like those production books.
This is another reason why the campaign's taking a bit longer is because it's a proper book now. It's turned into an epic making of book.
I'm excited about that.
You know, cause it's nice getting the making ofs with a few sketches in it and stuff like that. But then I thought to myself, I'm looking over and I'm seeing like the making of Alien sitting next to me. You know, the one that came out, the movie came out back in the late 70s. And I'm thinking, I'd like to make this a little bit, you know, something like that.
Mine would be like one page, me sitting at my desk. This is how it was made. Drawing. There's no glamorizing. It's not romantic. I was sitting at this desk for 200 hours.
Drinking some of that horrible juice you drink.
No, I'm not drinking that right now. It's just black tea.
Oh, black tea. That's good.
Some English breakfast.
That'll do. Yeah. But that's turned into a more of a thing. So anybody's getting that, that's going to be like a nice. Mm-hmm. And I'm having fun designing it as well because my background's in design more than anything. So I'm having fun with that. So yeah, that's not bad. That's not as if I'm out there promoting that much. So another back is great.
That's great.
Yeah, and that means my plan to get the Tidy Bogeyman out this year is not going to happen because I wouldn't release this until I've got EOSA fulfilled. Mm-hmm. But that's cool because I've got plans for next year and hopefully get some conventions coming up. So
that's lined up already.
Yeah, so get your name down here and I'll get an email out to everybody as soon as I'm ready to launch with us. As I keep saying, this is done.
The one that I've not launched is done. What's that? Oh, you said it's going to be hardcover?
It's going to be hardcover and soft cover, so you've got a choice. Yeah, and I'm looking into things like slip covers and stuff like that as well. So there's going to be like there's going to be options to get deluxe.
That's nice. That's a lot like Bruce Wayne letting somebody steal his wallet so he has a good head kicking lined up for the night. Just let him.
Yeah. Where did that come from?
I don't know. Found an app. All lined up. Great way to start the night.
Yeah, and there you go. Exactly.
Putting up art? Oh, the pages. I was going to say, I don't think I've been doing a lot of sketching lately. Aside from, I think the last thing that I put up that was a sketch was that Pete Cimetti watercolor, which is like a week ago at least.
Yeah, but you've been putting up all your comic book stuff, which is what you call your hobby pages.
Yeah, just practice, like high level practice. You know, you gotta go in there and treat it like it's real, and it will be real.
Super bound in human flesh, it is. You know what? That's a really good idea.
Not
for your work, but Dale's a mystery. That would actually make a really good idea for a slip cover. Got me thinking there, Pete. Good evening, 24 Eyes.
Hello.
So what kind of
movies have you been watching lately?
Well,
what you got?
Hang on, I'll get this down. Funnily enough, I was on German Amazon.
It's a second Tubi.
That's my two stops. I've got Tubi and I've got German Amazon. I told you I was on Tubi and it was because we've still got to do that.
Right.
Charles Band stuff, you know, all the human stuff, Phil Moon stuff. Mm-hmm. And I told you that I watched the episode 4 of Trancers and it was tortured and I kept falling asleep. And then they recapped the whole movie in the first 10 minutes of the next one and did the best. And I thought, I didn't need to sit through that.
I hate that.
Yeah. But and they were written by Peter David as well. Comic book
really?
Writer. I expected better. Yeah. Wow. But I was on German Amazon and I bought a Blu-ray of Invaders from Mars by Toby Hooper for £8.
Wow.
It's not bad at all.
Bad at all.
Yeah, so that's me sorted for next week to get to watch that in high def.
You know, sometimes though, watching those movies in high def it's not all it's cracked up to be. You get to see like the strings and things like that happening. I always reference Jaws on Blu-ray when you can see paint chips falling off of his face as Quint's kicking him in the head. Like you can see the gears in the back as he opens his mouth and you're going, oh, what?
Yeah. Well, Pete, if you get onto Amazon Germany, it's going for about £8 right now. It's the Koch edition, KOCH.
Koch.
Koch, aye. And I don't think there's any extras or anything on it, but it's a proper kind of official Blu-ray release. I think there's an American release, so I don't know what company it was, but there is a bells and whistles American release, but it's about 30-40 quid or something. And I quite like the movie,
like
but
Shout or Scream Factory,
yeah, I could probably it'll be with one of those.
Same company, but
yeah, it's different labels, the same companies.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you don't need all the bells and whistles for that particular movie, I don't think.
No.
You can just get an old issue of Starburst off of the internet library and read about it. Yeah, I also bought, thinking ahead, it was I bought like a Blu-ray collection of Cat's Eye.
Wow.
Silver Bullet.
Ooh.
And Sometimes They Come Back. Yeah, I know.
Just the first one?
Just the first one. It's for, I think that was 12 quid.
I think the second one's on Tubi.
Right, yeah. So I got all of that together for, you know, postage for less than 17 pounds. That's a proper bargain.
Ooh, beautiful.
So we need to do like a lesser Stephen King movie night some night.
Oh, yeah. I mean, how many? He's got so dang many adaptations as it is. That could take up quite a bit.
We could be here for weeks.
Weeks,
yeah. But as to what I've watched,
have anything to do with the story.
That's me telling you what I've lined up to watch. As to what I've watched, I haven't watched that much recently. Mm. Beyond my Count Yorga Blackula marathon.
Mm.
I'm trying to think.
Flipping through some of The Howling Six today.
The Howling Six, okay.
So it might be my favorite sequel.
Oh, I need to go into The Howling, so I'm letting you down because I haven't actually looked at them yet.
That's okay. It's okay. I mean, they're not amazing uses of your time, most of them. The thing about Howling 6 is I just think it would make a great freaking remake. Yeah, and you got a werewolf vampire fight. Like, it's cool. And it's like a Bark at the Moon Ozzy Osbourne werewolf, so it's very different than anything else in The Howling.
So, I mean,
that's got so much potential. Thank goodness Tubi still has like 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, I think, for The Howling.
So The Howling 6 is The Howling 6 Freaks.
The Freaks, yeah. It's all about a circus. It's a great story. Mm.
Right.
Very different werewolf, like I said. I wish they would remake these.
Give me a second. We're not going to have sound because, well, we'll get struck or whatever. But
rock.
Is this the one?
That's Bruce Payne as the ringleader vampire in the circus there. And then you got some decent B-movie transformation.
Yeah, it looks like the budget is...
But he's... It's a really weird werewolf when you... I swear somebody watched that Ozzy Osbourne music video and said, doesn't look expensive. But, oh, you get...
Oh, yeah.
Get to see...
That was something.
There's the vampire. Some great vampire makeup. Alligator boy.
It looks.
You're watching. It's like the whole movie.
Does that the whole movie? Excellent. Not bad at all. Probably give that a look.
It's better than the two previous before it. I love the idea for the stories. The fourth one being like a remake of the first one, the original novel, and the fifth one being like a whodunit. Which one to use? The werewolf locked in a castle while a blizzard kind of assaults outside.
So it's a combination of like werewolves, vampires, and freaks.
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's you know, the guy's, he's just like trying to live a good life. He's taken up with a pastor, his daughter, and they're restoring a church. And then this evil dude comes in with a circus and stirs stuff up. It's a heck of a story.
Does it have any ballet dancing in it?
If by ballet dancing you mean creature fighting, yeah. Yeah, it does.
You know what I mean. Yeah, the Howling 2, your sister is a werewolf.
Mm-hmm.
Or is it the Howling 3 that had the ballet dancing?
Oh. Three was the ballet. That was the marsupials.
Three was the ballet. That was the marsupials. Same director. Neither one of them makes any sense. To me, they're just a one big movie in my head.
That one cracked me up with like the end when there was like a giant like Australian werewolf that sticks its head in the in the tent.
Yeah.
Oh, it was pretty. But I did like the idea of like, you know, there's all kinds of different animals out there. They kind of tried to introduce that, like, you know, you could have a bear wolf, a werewolf kind of thing, or like a or a kangaroo werewolf kind of thing, or, you know, that's a that franchise idea. That was very ambitious. Just too dang bad they didn't have the acting or the budget to go with it.
No, just a crazy man at the helm.
That's right.
But it does, no.
But it swung for the fences. I'll give it that. Three was ambitious. Four, I mean, I got to give them credit for trying to do the maybe closer to the book. Five had a cool idea with no budget or actors, and six was just, they were like, let's have a monster fight. Six felt closer to what you might see like a Universal Monster movie. Or their best attempt at like a discount bargain bin kind of counterfeit Universal Monster movie.
Yeah, it looks like one that I'm going to be, you know, interested in watching.
So as a result, yeah, it was my favorite. It's not just great, just a warning.
No, it's still just howling. It looks like the cheapest of the all of them, but that's the only thing.
It's got some great monster makeup, though. I like it.
Yeah, here's the, well, here we go. I mean.
Poor Christopher Lee, man. What are you doing?
But this film is, even for the, it was dated for the 80s, in the 80s.
Yeah. For sure.
I'm sure it was supposed to be funny.
Oh, yeah. Well, absolutely. You look at like the ending scene or the credit sequence.
Yeah.
They're not taking anything seriously. This is like a, we can't compete with the original, so why try?
It's kind of like we never even bothered watching the original.
Style over substance. That's, this should have been the name of this movie.
Christopher Lee's like, he brings it though, doesn't he? He's just
in every movie he's in.
Yeah.
I just saw this one, this clip of him doing, you know, one of This Is Your Life. And they had Vincent Price come out because they were good friends. And Price told this story about how somebody went up to him and said, are you Christopher Lee? And he said, no. Or are you this guy? No. Well, who the heck are you? You know, and stuff. And talked about their friendship a bit. And Christopher Lee was just like big ear to ear smile. And at the end, it was kind of funny because he turned to Christopher Lee and he said, and what's your name? And Christopher Lee jumps up and says, it's Vincent Price. He went over and shook his hand.
Yeah, it's weird because you get people saying that he was like irascible and kind of like, you know, hard to work with. But at the same time, it seems that he actually has a good sense of humor and people liked him.
I think he's a hard to read person.
Yeah, I mean,
like dry sense of humor.
Yeah, completely. And also, I think they're hard to work with, but it's just he didn't suffer fools gladly.
I think he had standards. Yeah, absolutely. For sure. Because, I mean, most of the interviews and stuff I saw him in, if he wasn't explaining something, and when he was explaining, it was dead serious, you know, but he was, he'd smile and he seemed to have a heck of a self-deprecating sense of humor towards himself.
Yeah.
I don't think he ever got ego.
I just remembered what I'd watched recently. Yeah. Because I'm watching all the Halloween films. I had Ghostbusters. Yeah.
Oh, hey.
The original. That's quite a good film, though.
A few weeks ago. I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
Try the second one. He's an ego.
Yeah. No, I'm leaving that one. I think next year I'll watch that without watching the first one, because it's better to do it that way.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's aged pretty okay.
No, I think so.
It was in the cartoon.
Yeah, I think the problem with sequels when that came out was that previously people didn't have the originals on video cassettes so they could watch it before they went to see the new one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it come out like a decade earlier, people would have been well pleased with it, because, you know, it'll have been a year before they'd seen the first one.
So, well, I think the popularity of the cartoon changed it a little bit. I think they were trying to match up with that a touch more, because it was closer.
Yeah.
In terms of that, which I was watching some episodes of that, and it's held up really well. I watched one where he was like, they were fighting Cthulhu, for goodness sake.
That guy gets Cthulhu. He gets everywhere.
It's the last person I'd expect him to be in a kid's cartoon.
Yeah.
But hey, that's I've been on a silent movie kick again lately. They what is it? Scream. No, Keynote just released Hunchback of Notre Dame. Notre Dame.
Oh, so it was like a silent one you got.
Yeah,
oh.
Yeah. Yeah, it it was just released September 28th. So it's got a nice, beautiful new print and a bunch of special features and stuff like that. So I had to snap that up. And then I just ordered, because I've never seen it, the Golem, how he came into the
world. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That was like super discount.
I remember seeing that when I was a student. I was like, they were all on TV. They were showing a lot of the silent movies. And,
that was good.
But I haven't seen it since then. That would have been back in the 80s.
Oh.
Yeah.
And then I bought Hugo, because I haven't seen Hugo either. I keep on hearing good stuff about it.
The Scorsese one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I watched the start of it to see what the 3D was like, and it seemed quite nice, but I've not actually watched the movie. I've still not watched the whole movie.
Full disclosure, I'm not a huge Scorsese guy. I don't know what it is about his movies, but they're just not movies that I usually sit through.
Yeah, no, I'd
be different.
No, I like them. I'm a big fan. I almost met him.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he was supposed to come to a course that I was on, an art course, and because of whatever reason, he couldn't make it. There was a showing of Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, and he was meant to be coming and talking about it, and he couldn't make it, so he sent a letter of apologies. So damn.
Yeah, he should have sent Daniel Day-Lewis instead. You wouldn't have been able to tell the difference.
Yeah, well, if you know it, you could just come as him. This is before they started working together, though.
Oh, right.
Yeah, that's how long ago it was. Again, we're talking, back in the 80s.
Oh, for sure. Eventually on my list, I got to get Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, because Kino's got a print of that.
I was thinking we'd watch that some night.
Yeah. That'd be good. And then The Phantom Carriage. Really interested in that one.
Refresh my memory. The name rings
a
bell.
It's a Swedish movie, or Norwegian.
Oh.
And it's about a miserable drunk that dies, and he's got a chance to fix it, sort of thing.
Oh,
he takes
right.
Reins of Death's chariot, and they've got a lot of where they layer two things of film and bring the opacity down so he looks translucent, and cool. He's interacting with people because, he's a ghost. So he's standing in the room and you can see through him and death and stuff. So he's kind of taking charge of this carriage, which you get in the carriage and you get ferried away kind of thing. Because if you can't fix it, he's going to be death. That's just how it's going to be.
Right. Okay.
So
that sounds like a good one to watch as
like
well.
A very early special effects movie.
Yeah.
It was 1920. So actually, let me just share.
There you go. StreamYards is being kind of erratic with me tonight. I've been trying to bring up some. There you go. I got Pete up there. Apart from Cape Fear, Pete doesn't really enjoy any of Scorsese's films. This is where I am. I'm completely opposite to both of you guys. I like
die
all
on
of
that
his
hill.
Films. I like all of his films apart from Cape Fear.
Oh, really?
Pretty much, yeah. I like them all apart from Cape Fear. I don't like Cape Fear much at all.
Is it because you like the original now, or
I like the original? I saw what he was trying to do with Cape Fear, but it just didn't click with me.
Okay.
You know, I'd rather it had actually been. It's the same with Dracula, but Coppola, it feels like they're trying to replicate other directors' techniques and everything in such a showy way that it doesn't quite work for me. Yeah,
I just thought, now see, this is where Pete and I differ, because I thought Raging Bull was friggin' depressing. I'm just sitting there like at the end, like, well, suppose I'll just jump out the window.
No, that's a great film. I love it.
Kind of sucks that I'm on the ground floor, but
maybe point. Revisit some of them, because I was never the biggest fan of Goodfellas, but I watched it a few months back, and it's really good. I don't know why I was never the biggest fan of it. It's really good.
When I match Raging Bull, especially up against like Rocky or Cinderella Man or something like that, because usually boxing movies have like the most hope. And then you get that, and it's just like you're waiting for the hope to come, and it just it never comes. So, yeah, here's so they do a lot of that kind of thing, and it looks really nice. So that's on my list. Eventually.
Cool. That's a Criterion as well. That'd be nice.
Oh, yes. Yes, I like the Criterion. Dracula grew on me with each repeat view. Which one? Oh.
Coppola's.
Coppola's, yeah.
Give Gangs of New York a go again, Pete. That's an underrated one.
It's, I like this Coppola Dracula, but there's just some stuff in there that kind of makes me shake my head still. Just like making them all sad and sad and love struck and stuff. And I mean, I could see him being a guy that like some terrible stuff happened and he just became bitter and there's just no talking him out of it. I mean, think about every old dude you really met when they get like bitter and it's just, that's their new way of life. You don't talk them out of it. They're just bitter.
Exactly. And I'm looking forward to it.
And I mean, like Dracula, I could just see him just being like, I don't even care. It's my way.
I suppose so, yeah. And what got me was he was Vlad the Impaler. Is it the whole thing? We just go around impaling everybody, and they were supposed to have some sympathy for him and be invested in his love story. And I couldn't do it, you know?
Well, I also appreciate those priests that were like, when he found out that his wife had died, they're like, and now she's burning in hell. It's just like, hold on a second, hold on, pump the brakes.
Yeah.
Or is Anthony Hopkins too? And I can just, there's no salvation for her. She's burning in hell now. No, don't try to beg. It's just not going to help.
Yeah, I don't. I need to revisit it again, I suppose, maybe.
Eventually, I'll get it. I just got these two silent movies, so I'm going to wait a little bit. But yeah, I've got that and Caligari on my list.
Ashen got an awesome copy of Creepshow for Shout Factory.
Shout Factory is freaking great. I love Shout Factory.
I think it's region coded, though.
Yeah, I got to wonder if you guys got an equivalent over there.
Yeah, we've got a few different ones. Hmm. But I was looking for that one that Bristoli and Dave put up on Twitter. I like the look of that set, but I couldn't find it anywhere.
Which one was that?
It was both Creep Shows plus a documentary.
Oh, yeah.
I think it had Creep Show 3 in it as well.
Oh, then you don't want it.
No, but if it comes in a box set and it's, you know, a decent enough price, you take it, don't you?
You can turn that box inside out and like backwards and just say it's filler. It's a piece of cardboard to make sure the others don't go around.
Wouldn't watch it, but you know.
Yeah, exactly. It's a coaster.
Oh, unless it had I would watch it if I had a commentary, because sometimes see bad films, it's really interesting to watch them with the director's commentary.
Or they also get those film historians. I love those commentaries.
Yeah, I don't think I'll get them for Creepshow 3, though.
No, not for that. Well, you never know. I mean, because sometimes you get like a horror enthusiast.
Yeah, the Universal Horror ones are really good.
Oh, with like Tom... there's like three or four like hard film. It's like they write a book and then they just read it.
Yeah, the old guys with beards and glasses. Yeah,
exactly. can't very scholarly.
Exactly. But for the more modern ones nowadays, it's Kim Newman seems to do a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, or he just does introductions. So he had like a 20-minute kind of video of just camera on him and the Kim Yorker Blu-ray that I've got. He just talks about both movies and lots of stuff. And sure. I quite like that. That's kind of a good way of doing it because he's engaging and he really kind of likes what he's talking about.
Well, I noticed there wasn't much for that 1943 Phantom of the Opera because that was a miserable movie. I think Universal knew it.
Yeah.
I don't understand. I wonder what happened where they aren't using or can't use possibly the their Phantom of the Opera, the Lon Chaney. I know it's public domain and stuff like that, but they could certainly still, because it says a Universal picture on the poster. And they still claim it, but they don't use it. And then they just re-release this one, and that's not the that's not a good representation.
Yeah.
Same with was it Hunchback of Notre Dame? They the Lon Chaney, they Universal made that picture, I believe.
Yeah.
Something weird happened.
That's a really weird. That, I mean, okay, that Phantom of the Opera is really weird. The Universal one.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably one of the strangest. It's not even like a horror movie. It's one of the strangest movies that they put out.
Was their first horror movie?
Yeah. There's lots of different versions of it as well, and sort of like different cuts and all kinds of stuff.
Have you ever seen The Hunchback with Charles Laughton and Maureen O'Hara?
I have indeed. Yeah.
You like it?
And,
I don't think I've seen that one.
I do. I've got the Blu-ray that I bought recently. I've not watched it yet. But
okay.
Do you?
No, I was just looking. I was just looking at it, and I, you know, I've seen a couple different versions of The Hunchback, but I don't. I, how that one skipped. The last one I think I remember was the Hopkins version.
Oh no, the Charles Laughton one is my favorite.
Is it?
Yep.
Interesting. I'm gonna have to take a look at that.
Yep. After the Disney one, of course.
You like the Disney one?
No, that was a joke.
Oh, I was gonna say, like, my goodness, they missed the mark.
It's an interesting attempt. Yeah. Ashley was asking if there is a third Creepshow piece, right?
There is, but it's and like a series.
Yeah.
Yeah, Creepshow 3 was done like on a shoestring budget, and I might have to get that Laughton one.
That's good. Yeah.
That Disney one, my goodness, I think I saw that in the theater, and I, you know, it's such a weird mixed bag where you get like the cute cartoony gargoyles, but it's like, let's do your ABCs, damnation, eternal damnation. And then the priest is busy really trying to sleep with the Esmeralda and telling, like, if you don't go with me, you're going to go to hell. And I'm just
the gargoyles are singing about giving him the hump or something. I don't know. I can't remember,
but now I look back on this thing, and I was like, as a kid, it's like, it's not bad at all. And then I look back on it, and I'm like, what were they thinking? Why?
Yeah.
Hi, Jan.
That's it. A lovable hunchback.
Once again, trying to put a Timon and Pumbaa character where they shouldn't be. It's ridiculous. Same with Tarzan.
Yeah. Get some Jansplaining in that chat, Jan. Yeah.
Well, that's a great series.
It is indeed.
I do like that series.
Jan's channel for the Jansplaining. I kind of want to go and watch that now. That's
Which
great.
One?
That's just
Hunchback?
Yeah. It's one of these ones I bought. People know what I'm talking about. HMV over here do a kind of like a premium connection. And what they do every now and then, it's not really that premium, it's just back catalogue titles for different studios like Warner Brothers. But what they do is they have nice packaging, maybe slipcases, you know, original right. posters on
Make
them.
Make it seem nice.
Maybe a postcard or something inside it.
Mm-hmm.
I've got my Dracula AD 1972 that way.
Sure.
And that was one of these things where I kind of wait because twice a year they have sales. So whenever they have a sale, I buy like a dozen of them. So, it came with like about a dozen other ones.
You know, it's sort of a weird situation where you've got like, you take an original thing and you sit and reboot it. And each time it's like, this is already done. This is a movie. But it seems different when it's an adaptation of a book for whatever reason. You've had like 10 different versions of Dracula, 5 or 6 different Robin Hoods. They're all very different. They all kind of stand on their own. You could watch any one of them. It doesn't seem like a remake. Even though, you know, like to somebody that doesn't read, another remake. Or they may not even know, like it's an original. Like you look at that Robin Hood that came out a couple years ago. I've got it, haven't watched it.
I'm not interested in it. It kind of looks. Is that the Guy Ritchie one?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I quite like his kind of gangster movies, but not as much as Scorsese's. But that just kind of looked a bit dull to me.
Yeah. My wife, she's a big Robin Hood fan. We've got probably four or five versions. We got the Kevin Costner one. We've got the guy, or the, you know, the original, the from the 40s.
Yep.
Oh, I'm trying to think of who it was. The pervert guy. Anyways, yeah, you know, the one with tights. We got Men in Tights. We got the Russell
Errol Crowe Flynn.
One. Errol Flynn, that's the one. Yep.
Sorry, you just threw me there when you said, you know, the guy, pervert guy.
Oh, he was nasty. That dude. Certain parties, if you know what I'm saying.
They're PG. You never know. The way Disney's going, they might find some angle they could do that with. You never know.
yeah, we got the Disney one and stuff. And then I gotta have 8 or 9 versions of the Christmas character or Carol, maybe the same in Dracula. I've got 3 versions of Phantom of the Opera, I think. We should start collecting Hunchback. I don't know. It
you
just
got
seems
Phantom
different.
Of the Paradise yet?
No Phantom of the Paradise yet. And then I think I've got a few Three Musketeers. But yeah, that talk about very different when you do the Musketeer.
Three Musketeers is like, Robin Hood, the only ones you really need are the Errol Flynn one, which is pretty good.
Pretty good, yep.
You need the TV series called Robin of Sherwood.
Mm-hmm.
Right, have you got that?
No.
That you need that. Well, maybe you don't. Maybe you had to be a kid at the time to really enjoy it. But it's a good kind of like earthy retelling of it. And other than those, I don't know, the Disney cartoon, I think that does it for you.
Yeah, that's my wife's favorite. She liked the Errol Flynn. She hasn't seen the Costner one yet.
That's awful, but it's good. It's entertainingly awful.
And then the Russell Crowe one she saw.
The end of the Costner one, I saw it in the cinema in Glasgow on its first day of release. It was a Saturday. It was a preview of it. And it was cut over here. The censor really went at it. But the preview copy was the uncut copy, you know, with all the hand lopping and all the stuff that happens in it.
Yep.
And F-bomb for Christian Slater, all that kind of stuff was in it. So the kids were like loving it, they were watching it. But see, the very end when Sean Connery makes an appearance, the whole place just erupted, you know, because there was nothing quite as funny as Sean Connery as the King of England.
I don't know, Men in Tights nailed it when they got Patrick Stewart to come in and say that all toilets will be called John's from now.
Yeah.
It's good to be the king.
That was the only joke in the movie, though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I'm still on the fence. Hey, Dave. As far as Phantom of the Opera, I'm probably not going to get the Andrew Lloyd Webber one because I just can't do it.
Gerard Butler.
Yeah.
I haven't watched that, but I'm probably going to have to because I tend to watch all his movies now.
I don't mind musicals so much as like the Broadway style ones where it's like 100% singing. I have a hard time with that because it just seems ridiculous to me when it's like you're asking for a slice of bread and the other one's singing about, yes, I'd like some bread. And you're just like, oh,
cut off his hand.
Yes, say it.
Yeah, but that's modern musicals. They're rubbish.
Now there's the contentious one, the Phantom of the Opera, that, you know, it's like, does it even count when you're talking about the Robert Englund version?
Yeah. Well, that's another one I've not watched in years. Yeah.
It's like in name only almost. It's got just enough to call it an adaptation, but then it's like, oh no, he had a book of Satan that he wrote all his music in. And he sews his face on because he's Freddy Krueger, really.
Yeah, I quite enjoyed that. Yeah, I'm quite surprised that that Nottingham doesn't have a statue of Kevin Costner as Robin Hood.
Mm.
In much the way that Stirling has a statue of Braveheart, but it's actually looks like Mel Gibson. It's William Wallace, but it looks like Gibson.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, right, okay. Dario Argento's Phantom.
What's that?
Have you not seen that one?
No, what is that?
Oh, right. Pete, what do you think of it? Let's go. I'm going to get the trailer for
Mario
it.
Gento's Phantom of the Opera, huh? I didn't even know he made one.
That poster looks familiar, though. I quite like it, but I don't think you would.
Was he having his daughter have a bunch of sex and a bunch of scenes then in that? Like Dracula?
Lots of rats.
What?
Lots of rats.
Oh, lots of rats.
Yeah.
Hmm. Okay.
So it's like,
this doesn't look like I would think it would. Is his thing he's got long blonde hair? That's his problem? Oh, that is his daughter.
Yep, that's
I knew it.
That is. Yep.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Yep.
No, I hadn't seen this one. I didn't even know about it. Oh, is that Warlock?
It is indeed.
Ah.
There you go. See, now you're kind of wanting
Julian Sands.
To see it now, don't you?
I don't know. Julian Sands is a good actor. I'm going to give him that. He would make a good Phantom, but I'm just trying to figure out. It just looks like Warlock with long hair.
I've seen it once. Yeah, I don't have the greatest print of it. But I would, go for a decent Blu-ray of it and give it another watch.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
It's kind of like he's gearing up for doing his version of Dracula. Let's put it that way.
makes sense. Oh my goodness.
Pretty enough. Yeah.
You know
what? That's what I mean. It's one of these films. I think if you see it, if it gets cleaned up and it gets a good print, there's stuff in it worth watching. But
I get a little jealous sometimes. You guys,
I can't argue with that, PG.
And some of your releases over there, because there's this one movie. It's only been here on VHS. I think it's on YouTube. I want to say last I saw it was. It's called The Rune Stone, and I know you guys got it over there, at least
the
DVD.
Hang on a minute. That's the other guy with the long hair.
That's, that's the guy from Terminator. I mean, Die Hard.
Yeah, he's like Julian Sands on steroids.
Alexander's Goodenough, I think.
Goodenough.
Yeah. If I pronounce it wrong, it's Goodenough.
Yeah.
But I love that movie, and they've only released it Region 2. What a great flick. Have you seen it?
I saw it on a video rental on VHS back in the day. So, yeah.
This is a really cool movie about Fenrir, who's trapped in a rock, and he possesses this archaeologist and starts to turn into a werewolf, and you've got him, who's Tyr,
yes.
Lost his hand to Fenrir in the Legends and stuff like that. It's one of the only movies where she keeps her clothes on, too. And Peter Riegert in there is this like sarcastic cop, and he's freaking hilarious. He can't stop using the F word. They build jokes around that. It's great.
This is a full on VHS trailer.
Oh my goodness. I love this movie, and I wish somebody would get it over here. And it's got what's his face? The guy that has been old since he was 20 years old.
No. Yeah,
there's Peter Riegert. But this is a really underrated werewolf movie.
Yeah. Neither Hypercage.
This is a great movie.
Yep.
And it's got the old guy from Reservoir Dogs as the police chief. Yeah. It doesn't look it looks more like a warthog than a werewolf.
Yeah,
but I
remember this film, but it was one of my
That was
Friday night, after it'd been out sort of thing. So you put this on and then kind of half asleep watching it. I remember enjoying
it. Yeah, I think you can watch this on YouTube at least, which is good, because I don't want this movie lost. I don't know, it must be a rights thing or something, but that's a heck of a fun movie.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned Darkseid, because when Stato mentioned Robert Englund's Phantom of the Opera, all I ever see when anyone mentions that is a front cover of Darkseid magazine with that on it. And I remember thinking it looks amazing, and then finding out it wasn't quite as amazing as it looked.
Oh, the movie?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those going like, hey, Robert Englund looks like that. It's a shoe-in. Oh, man.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, it was Joan Severance.
I believe it was, yes.
Of Hear No Evil, See No Evil fame. I love that movie, too.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
Just give me 5 minutes and I'll find one for you. That's what I do.
That's hilarious.
You've got to love Google Translate.
I kind of wonder if there's even a decent print of it. You know, I mean, unless somebody like Shout Factory goes through and fixes it, the only prints that exist are VHS prints. So, you know, somebody were to like bootleg Blu-ray it wouldn't even look that great.
Yeah.
So it's weird.
Actually just checking that, you see.
It's just good. Like, what is it? Another one, Fright Night 2. It's still in rights limbo. Haven't seen that since VHS either. Maybe there was like a short run DVD, but it's going to cost you if you find one.
That's true. There is actually a UK release of, because you were saying it's in Region 2, on DVD.
Yep. Yep, you guys got it in DVD.
Yeah, as well, for just... I'm looking at a UK DVD release on German Amazon, as you can see.
Yeah, I'd seen that and I was like, because that's a great movie.
Doesn't look like there's a.
It's one of those, and it could be a little bit of nostalgia that goes with me, but I mean, like, there were so many fun lines and just cool situations that happened in that thing and. For whatever reason, it's MIA here.
I mean, just a big kind of werewolf claw. It's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he goes crazy in like this art exhibit, starts tearing people up, and at first they're thinking, you know, it's an art thing. He's killing somebody in this like live action art thing, and they're like, what is it saying? You know? And then he busts out and starts killing all the yuppies. Great times. Great movie.
Yeah. The 80s.
Oh, the 80s. Yeah. It's like the frontier.
What other films was he in? Then Die Hard guy? Because
he wasn't in a lot.
No, he had a short career where he was like a semi kind of lead. I'm going to check.
I could see him becoming like a Dolph Lundgren type dude.
Yeah, but you could tell from that trailer, he was the only one that was taking it completely 100%. Seriously.
I mean, he was a dancer first, so he was in Witness, he was in the Money Pit.
Oh, Witness, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, because he was the guy that
Oh, Waxwork 2. How could I forget Waxwork 2?
Is that the Sundown?
What's that?
Is that Waxwork 2 Sundown? Is that what it
was
called?
Lost in Time, at least, or maybe that's how it was here.
What I like am I Waxwork thinking of then?
That was a fun movie.
Right. What was the one with the cowboy vampires?
Cowboy vampires? Was that the first Waxwork?
The first one.
Maybe that could have been the second one. The second one was insane. Like, they took the first one and they just like said, you know, let's be really silly and let's just have these insane, you know, Waxwork exhibits.
I'm thinking Sundown, Vampire, and Retreat.
Well, that's a heck of a name.
Because it was made by Adney Hickox, who was the director of Waxwork 2, Lost in Time. I'm just getting my Anthony Hickox movies mixed up, as you do.
Of course.
Yeah, he also made Warlock, the Armageddon.
Is that the third one with Bruce Payne? No, it's the second one.
That's the second one.
With still Julian Sands. Yeah,
still Julian Sands.
I never watched the third one.
No, me neither.
It's like they just got another English guy that said, like, nobody's going to notice.
Yeah, no, if it doesn't have Julian Sands' quirky acting techniques, it's not the Warlock. He also directed a version of Prince Valiant.
Really?
1997. Has anybody seen? Oh, no, God, it looks awful. Ooh. That looks...
Prince Valiant.
That looks terrible.
I was going to say, is that Discount Patrick Swayze I'm looking at?
It looks like it. That's,
Stephen Moyer. From True Blood?
Ron Perlman, Edward Fox, and Joanna Lumley. I kind of want to watch it now.
I don't know why this reminds me of Space Hunter Adventures in the Forbidden Zone.
Yeah, tell you what it doesn't remind me of, Prince Valiant.
Oh, it's true. That's another one I got to track down. I think I got this cheap two-pack of Crawl and Space Hunter.
Cool.
I'll have to look at Crawl again. I haven't seen that one in a long time.
I kind of prefer Space Hunter.
Not to be confused with Cull, the Conan ripoff. Well, not ripoff. Yeah. Cull was his own book back in
Cull,
the day.
Yeah, King Cull, Cull the Conqueror, which is nothing at all to do with Robert
Kevin Sorbo movie.
Yeah, I don't think this Spanish Blu-ray is. It's probably just like a something that's been burnt onto a Blu-ray.
DVD or the VHS recorded onto a Blu-ray.
Yeah, you need to be careful. Yeah,
that's right, Hyper Kaiju Space Hunter with Molly Ringwald and what's his face? The bad guy, Dog. Michael Ironside.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that either. Because I saw it in 3D in the cinema.
Mm-hmm.
And 3D was half, it was half decent for
Ernie Hudson, too, was in that movie.
Oh, so he was. Yeah. It's a very odd movie because it's like a kid's movie, but it's not really like a kid's movie.
Absolutely not.
Not at all. Yeah. Is it? Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I didn't know that. Cool. That's going to my next to buy list. Check Amazon in Germany to see if it's there first.
That's why these talks are really dangerous.
he was no actor, the Invincible.
Wow.
It's really infuriating because the cult comics were really good, and all they had to do was just like make one of those comics into a movie, and they'd have had a good movie.
You know, I think though, as far as the cult movie goes, it was something like with a bigger budget and a higher budget, people would have wanted from a Conan movie. You know what I mean? Like they had like monsters, and they had like a big crazy witch lady. You know, that had magical powers and stuff, and sounds great on paper.
It does. But then they don't bother reading the source material. It's like they read. It's like nowadays, it's like somebody will read the wiki page of whatever it is they're adapting, and then they'll kind of change it all.
Oh, of course. I think they were in red and blue, weren't they, at that time? They had to have been.
No, they were kind of like gray.
Really?
And I don't know if it was a case of like, it was similar to when Third Rock from the Sun did their 3D episode.
Right.
And there had to be movement on screen. So whenever there was movement on screen, you were kind of like, you were able to see the 3D as long as it wasn't still.
Right.
I'm not sure if that's exactly how it worked in Space Hunter, but like I said, it worked well in three scenes. It doesn't work well in most of the movies. I think it was one of these things. It was an after.
Well, Hyper-Kaiju, those canon movies spawned a whole bunch of sword and sorcery B movies. None of them were close to canon. Yeah, well, you know, that just reminds me of Beastmaster. Every time I pass it on a menu, I have to yell, Beastmaster! And then just move on.
Yeah, I saw all three of them.
I loved them when I was a kid.
Yeah,
it's like Tarzan and Conan, like wrapped into one.
I liked what was the one with the Barbarian Brothers in it? I like that one.
Which one?
The Barbarians. I think it was just called the Barbarians.
Yeah.
And had these two muscle. Have you seen that?
No, I haven't seen that one.
Because they all came out in VHS here. It's like you had the gore movies as well. Oops! I thought I was going to get thrown out of my stream there. I've got some funny noises going on there.
The last 3D movie I saw was, I mean, you know, with the glasses and stuff was, if they put out a, it's long since out of print, but I have a copy. They put out a Coraline 3D, but it had like the purple and green 3D. It wasn't the red and blues. Oh wow, that looks.
That's god awful. That's the Barbarian Brothers. The film was The Barbarians.
That looks friggin' horrible.
Come on, tell me. Don't worry, what? Oh, they made another movie called Double Trouble. There you go.
Oh, geez. I think I remember that poster.
But I remember The Barbarians being one of the more entertaining of them. I think that was closer. It is, of course, a canon movie, so...
I feel like they'd be able to save you 15% or more by switching to Geico.
Yeah. So I think... I don't know. We might actually have to think about visiting The Barbarians at some point.
Oh, my.
For our canon specials, because we'll get there eventually once we'll get through the ninjas and the arm wrestling and everything else.
Yeah, I've got Friday the 13th in blue, or in the blue and red too, and I gotta say that 3D was not as impressive as I thought it was gonna be.
He's right, the right kind of horrible. That's exactly what it is. It's competently put together. It is. It's kind of.
How is their acting? About as good as.
Yeah, pretty much. I think, as far as I remember, pretty much.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, that's a rotational polarization. I'm glad you wrote that down so I could see that. That's it. Yeah. It would have kind of worked in some scenes where there was movement. It didn't work.
There hasn't been a 3D print of that since, has there?
No, there's not. I would buy it because I do buy all the 3D stuff. Because I've got Friday the 13th and Jaws, Amityville. Don't have the last one there, but I don't know if it's 3D. No. I'll check Amazon and have a look and see if they've got it in Germany, because there's a good chance that's the place they will have it.
Oh, I'm sure they'll have that in Germany.
Yeah, tell you what, the Spanish one will have it, but it won't be legit. Rotational polarization. Yeah, it worked really well when Third Rock from the Sun. Really well there.
I really miss movies like what Roger Corman did, what Cannon did, Full Moon do, like, where it's just like, this is a crazy off the wall idea. Let's just make it cheap and see what happens. Oh my gosh, people love it. Let's make three more.
Yep.
It's, the cheaper the movie, the easier the investment, because if you don't quite make it back, if five people go see it, you're halfway back to your, holy crap, is that Oliver Reed?
It is indeed, because I thought about that. I thought, I like Oliver Reed. You never seen the Gore movies either?
No, I haven't. I can smell the alcohol coming off him from here, though.
This is what you do when you get costumes lying about from other better movies. Yeah, these were like a series of books that were...
Is that Jack Palance?
Jack Palance as well, yeah. See, now you're beginning to think maybe doing the Barbarian canon special is a good idea.
Jack Palance took David Lopez.
Look at that poster.
My goodness.
Fantastic.
Reminds me of Abraxas.
Yeah, but these books, I read one of them back in the day, and they were just basically Conan meets sadomasochism.
My goodness.
So, of course, Boris Vallejo did the cover for it. Oh, that's a German release.
It's available
in Germany. I'm getting both in Germany.
Brilliant. Holy crap.
Yeah.
Never knew about this one.
Look at that helmet. That's amazing.
I feel like this should be stay buried in the sand. I'm that archaeologist that looks at it and goes, nope, and covers it back up.
Yeah, whose idea was it to do canon movies? Let's see.
Well, I didn't know about that one. Coming next week, Paramount movies. Not doing it. No,
Paramount movies. They were awful. They were like, it was almost like they knew the books were trash. And they were kind of like, how can we make something even worse? They truly are awful. I think the only way you could probably watch them would be if it was on like a PlayStation and you could play them at 1.5 speed or even 1.75 speed with subtitles and get through them.
Now that I think about it, Canon felt a lot like a meme factory for movies, where it would be like, all right, let's do a fairy tale. Ooh, let's do 8 fairy tales, sort of thing like that. And they just keep putting them out.
Feel free, DMs are always open, PJ. And I'm kind of like Pete. It's like you see them and you see that they've got the Boris Vallejo covers, which are so much better than anything in the movie. And you kind of think, if they're a half decent price, I'm hoping that.
Oh, for goodness sake, though. You know what the problem is? You look at those movies and you go, oh, it looks like it's not bad, but it's a lot like a pro wrestling trading card. You know, they're flying through the air and it looks like they're going to punch him in the face. And then you see the real thing. And it's just like this soft landing. And you know,
it's terrible. But the Barbarian Brothers are pretty good. It's like you appreciate how good they are when you see gore. I'm going down a sword and sorcery right here. I just feel like it.
What's that?
I'm going to go down a wee bit of a sword and sorcery right here and share one that.
Yeah, you don't see many of those anymore, do you? Sword and sorcery. Especially stuff like that.
Have you seen Hawk the Slayer?
No, what the heck am I looking at here? It looks like Han Solo stopped off.
It's Hawk the Slayer is. It's John Terry, who was actually in the Living Daylights. He played Felix Leiter. I think he was dubbed, though, in the Living Daylights. He must have thought, quid's in, I'm playing Felix Leiter, and then that was it, first and last time, like most people who play Felix Leiter. But this was an amazing movie.
It looks right up there with Goonies 4.
Okay, see the guy here in the far left, up at the top here? I'll go to the... Let's go to the page and see if I can pick it up. There you go. This chap here, he's a giant.
My goodness.
It's a case of like, So Bernard Breslau, who was in the Carry On movies, is the giant because he's the tallest guy in the movie.
It looks like Buckaroo Banzai in a Renaissance festival had a baby and made this movie.
It's amazing.
There's going to be flute music in there, I promise.
It's amazing. It's flying ping pong balls, glowing ping pong balls. It's got everything in it.
Do they have blades that come out from an old guy that says "boy"?
Most important of all, they have Jack Palance.
Oh, for goodness sake! It's like he's like the American. Who is it?
Just look at that.
It's just the
tell cash. Me you don't want to watch it.
Cash the check. It's like Michael Caine. He's like the American Michael Caine. I won't say no to a script.
I just saw that. Yeah, that's very naughty of you, Pete.
My goodness.
Yeah, Hawk, cracking kid, because it was a kid's fantasy film. Probably the budget was somewhere just slightly higher than something like Dark Shadows.
This is in the same vein as like Surf Ninjas. I can feel it.
Yeah, well, it's being they're doing a graphic novel now. I think they're doing a comic book of it, and I think it's going to be in 2000 AD, and they've got Garth Ennis is going to write it.
Oh dear!
Like either that or I just dreamt that somewhere. But I think that's
why aren't
true.
They remaking these old movies? Like these ones that had like a $10,000 budget. Why they got to remake like stuff that everybody already loves and were already high budget movies? I just don't get it. I don't. Because there's so many good ideas, good stories that like just didn't have the budget or the quality of actor they needed to really make it work. But no. And you know, we've already seen like with like say Stranger Things or something like that, that people like new stuff. And they also like remakes of stuff that sucked before, making it better. It's the only time nobody complains about remakes.
Just to make Pete happy as an entire...
What am I looking at here? Is this Emmanuel?
Katrina McCall.
Okay. She looks like a canon lady.
Well, she was in. Here we go. Some Lucio Fulci stuff, you know? So, we're talking City of the Living Dead. There you go.
Oh.
House by the Cemetery. There you go.
Well, it ain't no Alan Quartermain, I'll just tell you that.
I mentioned this before, but we had a cinema where you would go in and it was like they showed the weirdest things, because that's where I saw the double bill of Kiss Meet the Phantom of the Park and Future World.
Oh, wow.
So I had to sit through Future World to get to the amazing Kiss Meet the Phantom of the Park. But you would go in to see like an 18 rated movie and you're 13, 14 years old, and the woman that was selling your ticket would just sell you it. And you walk in, and then the woman that took your ticket would look at you and go, "What age are you?" And you would say, 18. And she'd say, "Okay." But you go in.
I would have gone older than that. I said I'm 35 and I got the Benjamin Button disease.
No, the only thing is what we used to do is sometimes you go and see like a double A or something like that, and you would say you were like 16, and then the week later you go back and you'd be going to see an X certificate and you'd say you were 18. The youth fine well, but it was a cinema that didn't get full houses. You could walk out of one hall and walk into another one quite easily, so you could finish one movie and then walk in at the start of another movie and nobody stopped you.
Right, but you got to be wearing a ninja outfit, like, you know, American Ninja, like even in a full lit, you got to have a black ninja outfit so you can.
Well, it was more like the denims that Franco Nero wore in the first ninja movie.
I was gonna say you a denim ninja.
Just more like that, enter the ninja.
No, I'd be really great if someone, you had like a corduroy ninja, right? And whenever like they ran you here, just like corduroy ninja. That might be a great comic.
Yes, the greatest ninja who ever lived, Franco Nero.
That ninja outfit makes sense for a winter movie.
Yep. As soon as he puts on the white ninja outfit, he miraculously transforms into, I believe it's Mike Stone, who then does all the action scenes.
My goodness, Scott Adkins, you got a rival.
I know, but
Scott Adkins was a good ninja.
Quite love Franco Nero. He was a great ninja. The second one of those was the best as well.
Is that one, the Tears and Rain or whatever it was? Like
Tears, aye, something like that.
Yeah.
We will be talking about this one because it will be part of our canon ninja.
Oh, boy.
I can't wait.
They got a few canon movies on Tubi, but not as many as I thought they would.
No. I think they're quite easy to come by else, you know, through other routes. But we're doing three of them next week.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking, because you mentioned earlier on, I was kind of, I get sidetracked by something in the chat, but I mean, are there any really bad movies out there you think would make good movies if they were to be remade?
Bad movies make good movies if they were remade?
Yeah.
Well, almost anything canon's got. Hey, Russ. I mean, you like look at, like, I was just looking at this canon collection they got. It's like 10 movies. So you got Missing in Action, Invasion USA, Cobra, Delta Force, Masters of the Universe, Over the Top, Bloodsport, Hitman, Hellbound, or The Hero and the Terror. Both of those could probably be remade into better movies. But
controversially, I would say all of those could probably be remade.
Well, I don't know.
They'd be as much fun. That's
how are you going to do Over the Top better than Over the Top did it?
I don't know.
Invasion USA was great. I like that movie.
Yeah.
Leave it alone.
That's a pinnacle. That and it was not a canon movie. The Lone Wolf McQuade. Those two movies are the pinnacle of Chuck's career.
Is that the one? I can't remember if that was the one where the guys are trying to make the bomb work and Chuck's standing on the roof. He's like, bomb doesn't work, huh? And then he like ties some wires. He's like, now it does. That's how I want those movies.
Yeah, ah, the good old days.
Oh,
yeah. No, I think. I think there's a whole bunch of things. A good idea taking movies that could be better and make them into, you know.
Well, it's tricky. Like sometimes you get something like Puppet Master, where there's such a certain look that's been taken over the last 10 movies or 12 movies or whatever that, like, remaking it would take a little of that charm away.
Yeah, and I'm kind of backtracking on that as well, because it does sound like a good idea, but then you think to yourself, the people that are remaking it, if they think that they're going to do a better job than the original, will they actually have any kind of like empathy for what the original filmmakers were trying to do?
Well, nowadays the answer is to give it to Blumhouse.
Yeah,
because they do horror, right? I mean, like, even if you don't like their movies, they make them cheap, and they typically try to make them scary. Like, there's not a lot of humor in a lot of those movies, because, you know, it's, or if there is, it's well placed. I noticed with the Blumhouse movies, like, they actually try to make scary movies. When you look at like Sinister, or at least the first one, or you know, Insidious, and those ones there, they really swing for the fences as far as trying to scare you, which is I think why they're in the position they're in now.
Yep.
And then they go and do some weird drama stuff like that that one jazz movie.
Yeah, it's like you know your wheelhouse, stick to it.
Yeah.
Oh, controversial question coming up here.
What do you reckon to the look of the new Dune?
He's talking to PJ, but I thought I'd pull that up because I know you love it.
Oh, yeah. Do you want to get me to get kicked? Hey, wait, what does the chat think of Dune?
Because, well, as PJ is saying, that's one for the remake.
Oh, I didn't care for the remake. I think I'm in a very extreme minority.
I haven't seen it yet. I'm waiting until it streams.
You might like it. I mean, it doesn't have like I don't know. The old one has, it's not great, but it's got a nostalgia factor to it for sure.
Yeah. I genuinely think that the old one would work brilliantly in VR. I think if you could place yourself some people in that world, it would really work.
I feel like the movie went by in slow motion. Like I was watching it at like 0.17, you know, 0.75 on YouTube or something like that. I don't know. I thought it was going to be longer because I mean, like the Eternals apparently is like 2 hours and 47 minutes or 2 hours and 40 minutes or something crazy.
Yeah, I'm not watching that.
Right. But I mean,
no, the cinema, I'm not paying.
I felt it go by on Dune. I really did. And I've never, of course, the thing is, I got asked to go do it, but I've never been a Dune fan. I'll be honest.
Yeah. Well, I loved the book because I remember reading the book when I was at school. I read the first three ones, the ones that count, you know, the ones that he wrote himself.
Right.
And I really liked the first Dune novel.
Well, I like the book for home defense. If somebody breaks in, throw the book at them.
That's it, throw the book at them.
But past that, like, you know, you go to court and you're like, but I was just trying to get into the novel. And he happened to walk in, so that was what was in my hand.
Yeah. Not the biggest Dune fans in the chat.
Well, I think, you know, if you watch it, just watch it on streaming where you can pause it, go to the bathroom, come back a week later. You know, when you get it.
I don't mind because I don't mind long movies in the cinema if it's a, you know, a good plush seat or whatever. But and as long as it's like an art house cinema and everybody's not eating crisps and using their phone.
Hey, we got somebody new in here. Sorry to interrupt. Hello. Hey there,
Glacier Mountain Comics.
We're just having a chat about movies today. Just talking with the chat, talking with each other about going wherever it takes us.
We're just seeing where we go. This is kind of what we do after we do the normal show usually.
Oh, for sure. So. Which I always say is like the real show, but Dune was a slog for me, but like I said, like you see like Anna, that Star Wars girl, she watched it and she really liked it. For the most part, she had some, well, she had a drunk review, but I mean, it's but it was just for me. I'm not a huge, I like internal politics and stuff, but when it's all about those politics, I just kind of check out a little bit. That's just me. No shame if you like the movie. I'm not gonna come at you and say you suck, but
yeah, I know what you mean. I've never brought myself to watch the miniseries, so I haven't watched them at all.
It's like 6 hours long, isn't it? Something like that.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious, you know, but
it'd be definitive if you were, yeah.
Recommendation for Pete, Last Night in Soho. It does look quite good, yeah. Hmm. I watch the start of trailers now and don't watch the end of them.
Yeah, because they give everything away now.
Yep. Kind of like that Runestone trailer.
Oh, yeah. Well, they used to do that in the 80s because there's this producer that was like, put the whole movie in the trailer and they'll decide if they want to see it. And you watch it now and you go, well, what's the point?
Indeed.
Not so much for me. I don't mind spoilers. I'm, you know, it's the execution of it, but.
Yep.
I don't know.
Right.
I don't know.
I don't know. I'm just, how do we wind this up tonight? Because
we could go on forever.
We could go on forever.
We'll just say.
I've got something else dark to draw.
Lots of movies.
I'm going to bring this up first. I'm going to.
Yeah, do that.
Yeah, hang on.
Lots of movies were mentioned. Go out and see them, or don't.
Look, it's here. It says
285.
Yeah, I wish Wise Guys was in the chat. He'd be telling people to subscribe and like, which I always forget to do. But please do hit that subscribe and like for us, please. I just wanted to draw attention to the fact, actually, Emma Dark, when we interviewed her, Sword and the Sorcerer was one of her favourite fantasy and genre movies, talking about sort of like cheap, tacky sword and sorcery movies we were talking about earlier. But I just want to draw everyone's attention to next week, because talking about not so cheap and tacky, we're talking about Life Force, Invaders from Mars, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 2.
Part 2.
So I'm looking forward to this one.
Now, Glacier Mountain Comics asks, have we ever seen Nocturnal Animals, directed by Tom Ford, came out in 2016? I haven't. It's got Amy Adams in it and Jake Gyllenhaal.
Oh, there it is. Yep. No, I have not seen that at all. I'm going to go on HM and Amazon after this and see if they've got it.
A wealthy art gallery owner is haunted by her near ex-husband's novel, a violent thriller she interprets as a symbolic revenge tale. Catch it tonight at 9.
Yep, I know. But we're going to show the art, Willie. What, for Life Force? But yeah.
Maybe your book?
If you're new, kind of like, give us a subscribe and whatever, and join us next week for, we're talking about Toby Hooper's slumming it at Cannon Movies with big budgets. Here we go. easiest way to get there is by my website. The website is terriercomics.com. The campaign, like, we've got another backer there, so it's looking good. And as I said at the beginning, but for anybody that's just joined us, we now have, you can get a werewolf poster if you want one. And we have the making of book on its own tier, because a lot of people didn't realize that you could actually get it as an add-on. So now I've put that
for
up.
Sure.
Somebody's already grabbed that.
And these are bigger magazines. These are A4 magazines, so 8.5 by 11.
A4 magazines, first two are 36 pages. The third one was originally, 52, but it's now 64, which has delayed it somewhat.
Giant size.
And some other stuff delayed it, but I'm mainly me working on this making of, which has turned into a big book itself. So, no extra cost. That's turned into a proper book, not just a kind of booklet. And everybody gets this lovely trading card. And more importantly, this gorgeous print from Stato.
Hey!
So, yay, it's going to everybody.
So, I see Hyper Kaiju is a Mathilda May fan.
Oh. There you go. Maybe I can't spit it up.
So he'll be excited for that Life Force.
Cool. Yeah. And there you go. This was another great cinematic experience, seeing Life Force in the cinema. Was it college? We said, what are we going to see? Well, that looks good. We're going to see that. But yeah, there's a campaign. That's what I'm working on. After this stream, actually, I'm going to pour a wee single malt and do a bit of drawing. Yeah, and there you go. Sign up for the Tati Bogoman's Tales of Mystery and Imagination. This will launch once I've fulfilled Ailsa Dark. And this one's already done. So it's like, maybe I should have launched this first. I don't know. But yeah. That was fun, just talking about anything that came to mind there.
Oh, for sure.
Yes, I can't. Russ is right. Life Force is brilliant.
It's one of those kitchen sink movies. I mean, I think they included the kitchen sink in there as well.
They may well have done. It's got an amazing cast. We'll talk about
that. Toby Hooper sat down and said, no bad ideas. Let's get a list. Zombies, vampires, aliens. Yes, all good.
Yeah, adapted from the book Space Vampires. She just called her that. That's brilliant.
I wonder if it's too close to Space Truckers.
Space Truckers. Yeah, that was something else, wasn't it? Anyway, cheers for joining us, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Pete, Russ, Hyper, PJ, Glacier Mountain Comics. That's a cracking name there. Dave joined us a wee while back. Michael was here. Everybody that's joined us tonight, and Ashen, and those folks in the in the Twitch that occasionally watches. I think the two viewers and on Twitch has been like the actual watchers in Marvel Comics, just standing there, not saying anything, but just looking at us. And everybody on Facebook, yeah, thanks for joining us. We'll be back at some point with the Barbarian Brothers. Until then,
when did that happen?
It's happening. Until then, cheers, everybody, and have a good one.
Good night, everybody. Thanks.
You have seen this incident based on sworn testimony. Can you prove that it didn't happen? Perhaps on your way home, someone will pass you in the dark, and you will never know it, for they will be from outer space. Many scientists believe that another world is watching us this moment. We once laughed at the horseless carriage, the aeroplane, the telephone, the electric light, vitamins, radio, and even television. And now some of us laugh at outer space.